No theme music?
No theme music. Dun, 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 dun.
Take your Bibles and go to Galatians chapter 6. I've had the Lord answer about 5 prayers for me this week, so it's been a blessing. One of them is that Lydia's off oxygen now, so
Hallelujah.
Happy about that. I really don't know what I'm going to say, so I'm stalling for time. Galatians chapter 6. Come down to verse 7. He says, "Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not." Let's pray. Father, pray you be with us here tonight. Father, be with me as I present your word and the message that you've given me, Lord. I pray you'd help me to present it in the right way, not to say things I shouldn't say, but to say everything I should. And I pray, Lord, you be the congregation. I pray you would bless them with this, Father. Help them to be reproved or rebuked or exhorted, however, Lord, you feel is best for their individual situation. I pray, Lord, that you would meet with us here tonight. Help this not to be a exercise in vanity, but to be something that's worthwhile of your presence. Amen. And I ask in Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to preach here for a few minutes tonight on reaping your wild oats. Used to be a saying they had, you know, "I'm going to go sow my wild oats." You know, you can do that anywhere. You can sow your wild oats in church. You can sow them in Bible school. You can sow them at home. You can sow them at your job. You don't have to be at the bars and the clubs and all those places of ill repute to sow your wild oats. They can be done anywhere. In fact, everywhere you are sowing something. Bible says your sin will find you out over in Numbers. It says, be sure your sin will find you out. And people don't believe in sin anymore. That's a concept that only is talked about in church, but people don't believe in it anymore.
Right.
People think that sin is just something the preacher says, something the Bible says, and if you have faith in it, then yeah, sin is something that you might believe in, but for the rest of us, well, we're educated and we don't need to believe in sin. My question is, if there is no sin anymore, why am I still reaping my sins? Your sins will catch up with you. They always do. You sow everything that you do. Everything that you're doing, whether you're thinking something, whether you're doing something, whether you're saying something. If you go talk to somebody, you're sowing some sort of seed, whether it's good or whether it's bad. And this passage is usually preached on a negative tone. It will be tonight as well. I want you to know that you can sow something good and reap something good. You can sow something to the Lord, and when he gives you your harvest, you have more than what you sowed originally. First thing I want to point out is where he says, "Be not deceived." Be not deceived. Go to John chapter 15. John chapter 15. There was a king one time who was talking to a preacher, not a priest, and he was talking to the preacher, and he said, "Every time I go to church, I feel good." He says, "But when I come and I hear you preach, I just feel mean." And that's how preaching is supposed to make you feel. Preaching is supposed to make you feel bad about yourself and good about God. It's supposed to make you feel fed up with the world and happy with the Bible. And so a preacher that does that for you is something that you should value. He says in John 15:22, If I had not come and spoken unto them, they had not had sin. But now they have no cloak for their sin. Cloak for their sin. Sin is always cloaked or disguised or masked or perfumed. It's made to feel, to look better than it is. People hide sin behind cultures. They hide sin behind their love for mankind. They hide sin behind historic positions. That's a good one. This is the way we've always done it. Must not be wrong. This is the way, you know, for you in your culture, it may be just fine for you to do it this way. But in this culture, they do it this way, and that's just fine for them too. They hide sin. Sin never appears like it always, like it actually is. It's always masked. In Romans chapter 7, the Bible says, "Was then that which is good made death unto me? God forbid, but sin, that it might appear sin, working death in me by that which is good, that sin by the commandment might become exceeding sinful." Sin doesn't appear like it's... If you open the door, doorbell rang, and you came to the door, and outside was a guy in a boogeyman mask, and he had a knife, and there was blood on it, would you let him in? Sin never appears like it's actually is because it wants to get something done that you don't want done. Over in Geneva, there's a lake there, and there was a castle on the lake, and it was made for prisoners. And what would happen would be sometimes the person who was over the prisoners would get one of them and says, "Okay, today is the day that we release you. And here, if you follow these steps down these steps, it'll take you right to the castle gate, and you'll be free to go." And the prisoner would have that spark of hope that would go up inside of him, and he would be going down these stairs, and he'd go down the first couple, and then after about the fourth or fifth one, he would fall about 50 or 60 feet, and he would die. They would bury him out in that lake. And sin's like that. For the first couple steps, it seems like everything's great and everything's fine, and I haven't been caught yet. It's going okay. Nobody sees it. Nobody saw it. Nobody sees it. God doesn't know what's going on. It was done in the dark. And go down 3, 4, 5, 6 steps. Say it's been doing okay so far, haven't been caught, and then finally it catches up with you. Sin is deceptive. You know, the commercials, they never show the end of sin. They never show what they're advertising, how it ends up in 20, 30, 40 years. They always show you at the beginning, you know. The name of each saloon's a bar, the fittest of its names by far. A bar to heaven, a door to hell. Whoever named it well. A bar to manliness and wealth, a door to want and broken health. A bar to joys at home impart, a door to tears and aching hearts. A bar to heaven, a door to hell. Whoever named it well. Sin always is presented as something dashing and debonair and something that you would want to be a part of. But it never shows you what actually ends up to all the other people that tried it. And that's what the Bible does. The Bible shows you the end of things. How immense appears to us the sins that we have not committed. You ever think about that? The sins that you don't commit, those are the really bad ones. Those are the ones that, yeah, we can all agree that those ones are bad. Go to 1 Kings chapter 12. First Kings chapter 12 is a turning point in your Bible. It's the kingdom had just split. Solomon, the wisest man that ever lived, had raised a fool, and his fool son split the kingdom. And now you got Rehoboam over here with two tribes, and you have this guy named Jeroboam that God picked out and said, "Hey, 10 of my tribes I give to you. I'm only giving 2 to the descendants of my friend David, but I'm giving you 10. And you know what Jeroboam did with them? For the next however many kings you read about, they said, and he followed Jeroboam who made Israel to sin. That's what he did, is he made Israel sin. Look in, come down to verse 26. What happened now is Jeroboam got his power and his authority now, and he's in his kingdom, and he's getting ready to run Israel, and there's a problem. The problem is that Jeroboam's up north up here, and Rehoboam's down south. You know, the good guys are always down south. You know that, right? Okay, just want to make sure everybody's on there. And Rehoboam's down south, and down south is the temple of the Lord, Jerusalem. Down there, just not too far from the Jordan River, going down towards the Dead Sea. And Jeroboam's thinking about it. He says, you know, I have all these people up here, but they have to go down there three times a year and make a feast before the Lord at that temple. You know what? If they go down there, I'm going to lose my people. So he says here in verse 26, and Jeroboam said in his heart, now shall the kingdom return to the house of David. If this people go up to do sacrifice in the house of the Lord at Jerusalem, then shall the heart of this people turn again unto their Lord, even unto Rehoboam, king of Judah, and they shall kill me. You think they'd kill him? Probably not. And go again to Rehoboam, king of Judah, whereupon the king took counsel. That's a dangerous thing. Whereupon the king took counsel and made two calves of gold and said unto them, it is too much for you to go up to Jerusalem. Behold thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee out of the land of Egypt. And he set the one in Bethel, and the other put he in Dan. And this thing became a sin for the people, went to worship before the one, even unto Dan. And he goes and he makes all these priests that God never called. The Bible says in Jeremiah, the heart is deceitful above all things, and desperately wicked. Who can know it? I, the Lord, try the reins to give to every man according to his doings, I think he says. Jeremiah 17, the heart's deceitful. Not just the heart, your heart's deceitful. My heart's deceitful. Jeroboam's heart's deceitful. He said, he made the problem bigger than what it actually was. He said, they're going to kill me. Well, if they're going to go down there and serve the Lord, if he lets them go, they're probably not going to end up killing you. And he says, when he goes to present it to the people, he says, it's too much for you.
Right. Yeah.
He turned the thing and he twisted the thing to, so it was all about them, or they thought it was about them, so he could accomplish his purpose. Have you ever done that? Have you ever twisted something in such a way and manipulated somebody to get what you wanted? So you could get what you wanted, but you made them think it was what they wanted. You know what that is? That's your deceitful, desperately wicked heart. And that's what, it doesn't appear that way. That's not how you remember the story going, right? But it's how God recorded what happened with Jeroboam here. You ever take God's name in vain? Say, well, I'm a Christian, I don't do that. What about when you pray and your mind wanders off and you just start talking in memory and you take God's name but you're not really talking to him? There's more ways to take God's name in vain than just in curse words. You ever bear false witness against your neighbor? How about telling a story and saying that you won the argument, presenting it in such a way that you came out on top and you didn't really come out on top? What are you doing? You're giving a false story. You're bearing false witness against your neighbor. You ever steal years off your parents' life because you live like the devil? Off your wife's life? Have you ever put a burden on your wife that is too much for her to bear and you won't lift it with one of your fingers? Say, what is that? That's your deceitful heart. That's you thinking that you're doing okay, and the Lord's looking at these things, and he's tallying them up, and he says, that's wrong, that's wrong. And you know what it is? Sin is deceptive. You think you're doing things right, and you think you're going by the book, and you don't know that your own heart is plotting against you and making you think that you're doing okay when you're actually, chief of sinners. That's what Paul said, right? You ever take the glory for something that God did? You know, we think about God doing all these miracles in the Old Testament, right? He parted the Red Sea, and he called fire down, and he burned up those captains of 50, and he did all these things. And in Acts chapter 12, after the crucifixion, we are in the New Testament. We are after the death of Christ, after the ascension, after Acts chapter 7, when God turns away from the Jews, and he starts dealing with the Gentiles. What happens in Acts chapter 12 is God kills a man because they said that, hey, that's not a man speaking, that's God speaking, and he didn't correct them. And he stole God's glory. And have you ever done that before? Have you ever taken credit for something that God did or not given God the credit that was due him? God gets serious about stuff like that. You ever offend a little one? God takes that very seriously. You say, well, no one's watching me. I don't ever do something like that. People are always watching you. Turn to Acts chapter 13. Acts chapter 13. You know, we do these sins and we hope that since we forgot about them, God forgot about them. But when you sow something, it doesn't matter if you forget about it or not, it's coming up, right? You can put a whole bunch of things down on the ground and you can go away and have a vacation and something's coming up. It doesn't need you there 24/7 to take care of it. Something's going to come up from it. Acts 13, look in verse 10. And said, O full of all subtlety and all mischief, thou child of the devil. Well, that must not be a Baptist. Thou enemy of all righteousness, wilt thou not cease to pervert the right ways of the Lord? You say, well, I'm not an enemy of righteousness. I go to church. I'm not a child of the devil. I read my Bible. He says, wilt thou not cease to pervert the right ways of the Lord? When you pervert the right way that the Lord has things set up, you fall into this category of what he's talking about. That would be your Bible correctors. That would be your queers. That would be your husbands that don't take responsibility for your household. That would be a wife that's not submissive to her husband. Whenever God has the right way, you say, well, that's not the way I'm going. You have perverted the right ways of the Lord. And you fall in this category where we would never place ourselves. You know why? Because sin is deceptive. It never appears like it actually is. It always tries to trick you and make you think something different than what's actually going on. It always starts small, too. You ever notice that? Nobody just wakes up one day and becomes a serial killer, right? Something happened a long time ago, and then something else happens, and then something else happens, and nobody stops it along the way, and it keeps going, and it keeps going, and nothing stops it. And then finally one day they say, well, what happened? I don't know. Just woke up this way. No, you never wake up that way. Sin always starts small, and then it builds. Sin is first pleasing, then it grows easy, then delightful, then frequent, then habitual, then confirmed, then the man is impenitent, then obstinate, then he is resolved never to repent, and then he is ruined. Well, he didn't start out ruined. What happened? Oh, just a little dab will do you. It's okay. Nobody's watching. I can handle it. I'm a man. I can take care of it. No, you can't handle sin. Let me ask you something. Which is worse, drinking, adultery, or murder? What would you say would be the worst of those three things? What do you think is the least of those three things? Drinking, adultery, murder. You know, if you do the first one, you're liable to do the next two. A lot of people have. You start out with just this thing, oh, this is not as bad as that. You know, it's just a little drink. It's not that bad. But you're liable to do the next two. A lot of people have. A lot of people have. Why? Because sin starts small. Just starts out a little bit. It never takes you, well, I would never do that. Well, not immediately you wouldn't. Sure. But it progresses. If you would be free from sin, fly temptation. He that does not endeavor to avoid the one cannot expect God to protect him from the other. If the first sparks of ill were quenched, there would be no flame. For how can he kill that dares not be angry? Or be an adulterer in act who does not transgress in thought, or be perjured that fears an oath, or defraud that does not allow himself to covet. Sin always starts small. The devil's not going to tempt you with something big. He's going to say, oh, you're okay, you would never do this. And then he takes something small and something that you're okay to let in and say, I can handle this, you know. Everybody else does. Look how they are. I can handle this. And the devil says, yeah, you can handle it. You got it. I mean, look at so-and-so. He does that. And you say, I can take this. And then a little bit longer, it becomes, well, that's not enough for me anymore. I got to have something a little bit stronger now. And the devil says, well, here, look what I cooked up for you. A little bit further on, that doesn't do it anymore. You need something a little bit stronger. And then pretty soon, you're way over here. And you look back at the thing that you started with, and you're like, that's not even a sin. But it is. It's just that you're way over here, and you're jaded to it. And pretty soon, what was way down there and looked like you would never do becomes reasonable now. You can figure out how somebody would do it. Look at Proverbs chapter 1. Sin is deceptive. Proverbs chapter 1, not only that, he says, be not deceived, but then he says, God is not mocked. You say, well, I wouldn't mock God. He must put it in there if somebody does it, right? Somebody must be doing it. Paul's writing to Christians in Galatians. Somebody must be mocking God. He says in Proverbs 1, this is a side of God they don't talk about too much, but it's in your Bible. He says in verse 24, because I have called and you refused, I have stretched out my hand and no man regarded, but ye have set at naught all my counsel, and were none of my reproof. Says, I called, you didn't answer me. What is God going to do about it? Well, I know what he's going to do about it. He's going to sit up there, and he's going to cry, and he's going to beg, and he's going to just plead that you would please just do right. Not always. Verse 26, I also will laugh at your calamity. I will mock when your fear cometh. When your fear cometh as desolation, and your destruction cometh as a whirlwind, when distress and anguish cometh upon you, then they shall call upon me. He's going to be busy, but I will not answer. They shall seek me early, but they shall not find me, for that they hated knowledge and did not choose, look at that, the fear of the Lord. No fear, right? I'm not afraid of that. Well, I'm not a sissy. I can do that. They didn't choose the fear of the Lord. They hated knowledge. God says, hey, I called you, and you didn't listen to me. Now you're going to call me, and I'm, what? I can't hear you. I'm busy. And then he says, I will mock when your fear cometh. I believe this is talking about a lost person. I think God treats his children a little differently. But God does give, you do reap what you sow. You definitely reap what you sow. But what a thing for the creator of the universe to stand before his creation and make fun of them at the white throne judgment. Can you imagine that? They're getting ready to drop off into hell, and he starts making fun of them. He starts mocking them. He starts laughing at them. Why? Because that's what they did to him. That's what they did to Jesus Christ. That's what they do to him every time somebody tells him to get saved. They said, I don't want anything to do with that. God says, you refused me, I stretched out my hand, and no man regarded. He said, I'll do the same to you. Remember what he said when he's talking to a Christian, a parable on the kingdom of God. The guy says, well, I knew you, that you were an austere master. You reaped where you didn't sow, and you picked up where you didn't plant, and God says, out of your own mouth will I judge you. You ever think that one day you'll get to heaven at the judgment seat of Christ, and God will pick the same words that you decided you were going to live your life by. He said, I'm going to judge you just by these things that you decided. God, you reap what you sow. Psalms 37:13 says, the Lord shall laugh at him, for he seeth that his day is coming. He says, keep it up. I got something planned for you. And he's laughing at him. You know, the guy says, well, I just laugh at God, you know, and I'll make jokes about the deity of Christ and the virgin birth and God sitting up in the air. And he's snickering. Why? Because he sees his day is coming. That's not the side of God that you'll find on TV, but it's in your Bible. Sisera, remember Sisera? Sisera was going out. out there, and he ruled over Israel for a while. I think it was 20 years. And he had 900 chariots of iron. And God called, used Deborah to get a hold of Barak, and he said, "Hey, I need you to go fight this guy, and I tell you what, you go out and you fight him, and I'm going to bring Sisera down to you." God's going to bring Sisera? I guarantee you what Sisera didn't think waking up that morning. He didn't think, "Hey, God wants me to go down to this battle." I bet he got up the same day as every other day, and he's like, "Hey, I think it's a good idea if I go whip the children of Israel. I've been doing the same thing for 20 years. I can do it." And he didn't know that God was calling him to a place of judgment and that the score was going to be settled. And God was going to take care of things. He thought it was his idea. And God put it in his mind, said, "Hey, why don't you come down here? It's a great idea." And he took him down here to the place of judgment, and he got killed. He got a tent nail through his head. There was a young man, about 18 years old, and he was feeling the conviction of the Lord on him, and that he needed to get saved. But he was 18, he was in the prime of life, and he thought, "You know, there's time enough. I don't need to do this now." And he put God off. And he put God off, and then he started working with some people that were pretty ungodly, and the subject never came up again. He drifted further and further away from church and away from God. And then at 35, some things started to go bad in his life. And he got some time to be serious and have some serious reflections on what was going on and think about his life and how it was going to end up. And he starts trying to find out about God and what things are going on. He even starts to pray and inquire about the Lord. And as he does that, his job moves up. He gets promoted. He's over these people now. But the problem is that the business is open on Sunday, and he'd lose a lot of customers if he closed on Sunday. So he doesn't have time to go to church anymore. And he gets busier and busier into his work, and pretty soon that call that was so sharp and so important to him doesn't feel so important anymore, and it's kind of quiet, and it's kind of moved away from him now, and he goes on with his life. And he reaches the age of 72, and he sees death again. He doesn't die, but he gets pretty close. And instead of hope and salvation, he sees fear and judgment and fire. And he starts thinking about these things, but it still seems like a ways off. You know, it's not something as pressing as it was when he was 18 or 35. It doesn't seem as strong of a pull on him. And this preacher starts coming by and visiting him, saying, "Hey, you know, you need to get saved. You need to get saved." And the guy's like, I hear you, but it just doesn't seem that important anymore. And the pull's not there. And there seems to be a barrier between what the preacher is saying and anything getting through to the man. And it goes on and on that way for months. And finally, the preacher is there trying to talk to him and telling him about the thief on the cross and that there's always hope for him and that as long as he's still breathing, you know, he can get saved. And he reaches up his hands and he says, "I'm lost, I'm lost, I'm lost." And he lays back on his pillow and he dies. Say, what is that? That's "they shall call upon me, but I will not answer. They shall seek me early, but they shall not find me." I believe as long as a person is breathing, there's a chance for them to get saved.
Man.
You need to witness to them. You need to work on them. Yep. But I believe that there are times where you find these people who have rejected God. And they've rejected God, and you've rejected God. In Romans chapter 1, you know what God says? He gave them up. And God says, "You've turned me down too many times." And you can read about them. You can get the deathbed testimonies. You can find out these people were on the verge of getting saved at some point in their life, and they rejected them. And then they rejected them here, and they rejected them there, and they hardened their heart like Pharaoh did. Finally, there was no hope. And they didn't have the faith to get saved. And they couldn't get saved. And they tell people, "Don't live like I lived." And they want to get saved. But they end up dying and going to hell. Because God says, "Hey, when your fear cometh, I'm going to laugh at you, I'm going to mock at you, because you called to me, but I'm not going to answer." Say, that's a scary thought. Yeah, that's a scary thought, because the Bible says, "Be not deceived, God is not mocked." And people think they can just, you know, mock God and turn him down, and God will be okay, because he's a big Santa Claus up there in heaven. But God's not that way. Turn to Proverbs chapter 1. You should already be pretty close. Look in verse 31. He says, therefore shall they eat of the fruit of their own way and be filled with their own devices. Not only shouldn't you be deceived, and you should remember God is not mocked. There will come a time when he won't listen. But you need to remember that you reap what you sow. You reap what you sow. You know, Herod had an opportunity to get saved. He had John the Baptist, the greatest among women, right? The greatest prophet born among women, the Bible says. And he had him captured in a prison cell, and he'd go here and preach. But it was more of a curiosity. It never really affected anything that he did. And he turned down and he rejected the preaching of John the Baptist. And one day he hears about this guy named Jesus Christ. He says, I've heard about that guy. He's done all these miracles. He's raised the dead. I want to see something like that. So he gets Pilate to send him over there. And Herod tries questioning Jesus Christ. You know what happens? He just stands there like a deaf mute. And he doesn't say anything. Say, why? Because Herod rejected John the Baptist's preaching. Jesus Christ rejected Herod. Therefore they shall eat of the fruit of their own way and be filled with their own devices. You know, Jacob lied to his dad about being the oldest. He said, yes, I am Esau. He was not Esau. You know what happened? Somebody lied to him about an oldest daughter and married the wrong one, right? Laban says, oh yeah, I'll bring Rachel. Bring her right over to your tent. And ended up being Leah that he married. Jacob lied to his dad using goat's hair, right? He put goat's hair on his arms so they would be all hairy like Esau. You know what happened? A couple years down the road, his sons lied to him and made him think that goat's blood was his son's blood. Say, what is that? For the turning away of the slim, therefore they shall eat of the fruit of their own way and be filled with their own devices. Jacob, his sins and his lies, and his envy for what his brother had cost his dad 20 years where he couldn't have his youngest son. His youngest son was gone for 20 years. You know what happened to Jacob? He lost Joseph for about that same period of time, somewhere about 20 years. He lost his favorite younger son, and it's for the same motive, for envy. What is that? That's reaping what you sow. You put something out there, it's going to come back and bite you. Job chapter 4, verse 8 says, even as I have seen, they that plow iniquity and sow wickedness, they reap the same. You'll get what's coming to you. I was talking to somebody the other day. I said, you know, you're going to end up, life isn't fair. That's what I told them. And they said, yeah, that's good to know. And I said, no, it's good that life's not fair. It's good that you don't always get what's coming to you. I said, because then, you know, can you imagine reaping everything bad that you've done wrong? Everything. And we usually don't count all our sins that we've done throughout the day. Or since the time we were a little boy or a little girl. But can you imagine for everything you did wrong, God coming down with a hammer and hitting you with it? So that's a good thing. I said I would have my fling and do what a young man may, and I didn't believe a thing that the parsons had to say. I didn't believe in a God that gives us blood like fire, then flings us into hell because we answer the call of desire. And I said religion is rot, and the laws of the world are all, for the bad man is he who is caught and cannot foot his bill. And there is no place called hell, and heaven is only a truth, when a man has his way with a maid in the fresh keen hour of youth. And money can buy us grace, if it rings on the plate of the church, and money can neatly erase each sign of a sinful smirch. For I saw men everywhere hot-footing the road of vice, and women and preachers smiled on them as long as they paid the price. So I had my joy of life, I went the pace of the town, and then I took me a wife and started to settle down. I had gold enough and to spare for all of the simple joys that belong with a house and a home and a brood of girls and boys. I married a girl with health and virtue and spotless fame. I gave and exchanged my wealth and a proud old family name. And I gave her the love of a heart grown sated and sick of sin. My deal with the devil was all cleaned up and the last bill handed in. She was going to bring me a child, and when in labor she cried, with love and fear I was wild, but now I wish she had died, for the son she bore me was blind and crippled and weak and sore, and his mother was left a wreck, it was so she settled my score. I said I must have my fling, and they knew the path I would go, yet no one told me a thing of what I needed to know. Folks talk too much of a soul from heavenly joys debarred, and not enough of the babes unborn by the sins of their fathers scarred. Your score will get settled one way or the other. God will always find a way to catch it up to you. And that's not something that you want to reap, but you will know. The longer you live, you will reap what you sow. That's why the Bible warns you about it, because there's a way to get around that. Don't sow wild oats. It's really simple. You ever wonder why people in the 60s and 70s are more conservative than they were in their 20s and 30s? Because they figured some things out. They had some time for their ships to come in. They're like, hey, this doesn't add up. I sowed a little thing, I got a lot more back. Go to John chapter 4. John chapter 4. Look in verse 36. And he that reapeth receiveth wages and gathereth fruit unto life eternal, that both he that soweth and he that reapeth may rejoice together. And herein is that saying true, one soweth and another reapeth. I sent you to reap that whereon ye bestowed no labor. Other men labored and ye are entered into their labors. Not only will you reap whatever you sow, but you'll reap what someone else sows. And sometimes you'll sow and somebody else will reap it. You ever enjoy the ability to have free speech? You know where that came from? Came from a Baptist preacher that thought that America was going the wrong way with the Constitution. Said, hey, if we're not careful, you're going to edge us out. We need a Bill of Rights. And so they got with Adams and forget the other guy's name they got with, and they pushed and they pushed and they pushed, and they got a Bill of Rights in there. And you're thankful now for that free speech that you did not sow, but you're reaping it, right? You will sometimes sow something you will reap things that you never sowed. And you'll sow sometimes and somebody else will reap. You'll plant, you'll plant, you'll plant, and you'll witness. And you say, I don't see any results. Somebody comes along and they reap all the results. And you're like, I've been doing this for 15 years. I haven't gotten anything. Why? Because sometimes you sow, sometimes you reap. But you will pay for what someone else sows. Sometimes that's good, sometimes that's bad. You'll pay for your sins and your kids. Your kids will bring you a harvest of sins you forgot about years ago. And you say, well, I don't believe that's fair. You can believe whatever you want. It's going to happen. Adam, what happened with him? How did his sons turn out? He reaped it in Cain, right? What about David? He messed up with Bathsheba. What did he do with Bathsheba? Well, he killed a man, right? Two of his sons die. He rebelled against the word of the Lord. One of his sons rebelled and took his kingdom. And then he had a sin of a sexual nature, and someone raped his daughter. Say, what is that? He's reaping it in his kids. Saul, right? Saul rebelled against the word of the Lord. You know where that happened? What happened to his kids? They died with them in battle. Why? Because of something they did wrong? Something their dad did wrong. Daniel's enemies. Their kids were fed to the lions. Why? Because they tried to get Daniel fed to the lions. Zedekiah said, I am not leaving Jerusalem. Jeremiah says, hey, if you go out there and you give up, you know, you'll live. God will take care of you. You'll be just fine. He says, I'm staying. Nebuchadnezzar came in and killed both his sons. Achan, remember Achan? 30 men died because of what he did. His sons died. Solomon, he decided to end his life in foolishness. The wisest man that ever lived had a fool for a kid. Lost the kingdom. Ahab, his kids were killed. You will reap your sins in your kids, one way or the other. I tell you that now, young people, so you can be careful what you do now, because it will come down the line later. There was an army officer in World War I, and he was married, but he didn't act like it, and he'd go to the houses of ill repute over there. A lot of people do that when they're overseas, and people are okay with that. They say, oh, well, it's, you know, what happens over here stays over here. Come back, and he forgot about it. About a year later, he had a little daughter. Didn't know he picked up syphilis while he was over there. Daughter was born blind. Every day he'd sit there and watch her try to run into things and feel her way around the house. What is that? That's a kid who is innocent, reaping the sins of the parents. When God says, be sure your sin will find you out, you better make sure it's coming true. And you, Bible is trying to warn you. It's trying to stop you. It's trying to say, hey, don't go this way.
Right.
You know, you can have your sins forgiven, but the consequences will still be there. Now, sometimes the mercy of God just overwhelms you, and his loving kindness comes down, and he takes away those consequences. But by and large, the rule is those consequences stay. You reap more than you sow. You don't put one kernel of corn in the ground and get one kernel back, right? Otherwise, we'd have no farmers. Hosea 8:7 says, for they have sown the wind, and they shall reap the whirlwind. You know, you sow one thing, say it's just a small thing, it's going to grow into something bigger by the time you get it back. Now, on the good side, you work down here for 5 years, for 10 years, for 70 years for the Lord, you're getting an eternal reward that can't be measured to what you sowed down here. I mean, you didn't do anything that should have lasted for eternity. You can't. You're finite. But you sowed something finite and reaped something eternal. Works the same way on the other side. You 5 minutes can cost you 30 years in prison. I've seen sins that one person did, and it was reaped for 4 generations. You say, what is that? That's sowing and reaping. You always get more than what you sowed. You say, it was just a little oats. You're always going to get back more than what you put in. So why can't you bring me a positive message? Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Sin's funny when it's on the movies and it's on the TV and it's happening to somebody else. They always find a way to make sin funny and cheek. But when you actually have to live it out, when the ships start coming in and you're reaping what you sowed, sin isn't funny anymore. Look in 2 Corinthians 9, look in verse 6. But this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly. And he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. You know, you reap according to how you sow. You sow a little, you reap a little. Now, you're going to reap more than you sowed, right? You put in one kernel of corn, you're going to get a stalk. But if I put in thousands of pieces of corn, I'm going to get a lot bigger harvest than somebody who just planted a couple hundred, right? You reap according to how you sow. You sow a little, you reap a little. Paul did everything in his power to hurt those that trusted in Christ. He went all the way, 100%. You know what happened later? The Jews did everything in their power to hurt Paul. They were a group of, 30, 40 guys? Said, hey, we're not going to eat till he dies. You're going to reap what you sow. You sow a little bit, you're going to reap a little bit. Sow a lot, you're going to reap a lot. Let me read you something here. He says, when I stand at the judgment seat of Christ and he shows his plan for me, the plan of my life as it might have been had he had his way, and I see how I blocked him there and I checked him here, and I would not yield my will. Will there be grief in my Savior's eyes? Grief, though he loves me still? He would have me rich and I stand there poor, stripped of all but his grace, while memory runs like a hunted thing down the path I cannot retrace. Then my desolate heart will well nigh break with tears I cannot shed. I will cover my face with my empty hands. I will bow my uncrowned head. O Lord, of the years that are left to me, I give them to thy hand. Take me and break me, mold me to the pattern thou hast planned. God has a plan for you. Say, well, I've given Christ enough. Sow a little, reap a little. You want a big reward when you get to heaven? Sow a lot down here. Some of it may be like the sins that you hope don't come up. He said, I sowed and I got nothing for it. I've been working for the Lord and I don't see any results. Well, sometimes you sinned and you didn't get any results from that either, right? You got a crop failure on the bad side. Sometimes you get a crop failure on the good side. You know how to do that? Hedge your bets. Do a whole bunch, right? That's what they tell you about investing, right? Put a little bit in this category, a little bit here, a little bit there, a little bit there. Spread it out. Keep going. Keep investing. You know what that will do? That'll get you through a stock market crash, right? If you just put some a little bit faithfully, you know who the stock market hits? Those who put in lumps and take out lumps. I'm going to go for the Lord. I'm going to work for him. A year down the road, you can't find him. And then those are the people the stock market hits, spiritually speaking. You want rewards in heaven, be faithful. Keep sowing. Lastly, go to 1 Corinthians chapter 4. Lastly, you will reap. You will reap. He says, be not deceived, God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. You know, sometimes the Lord says may, and sometimes he says shall. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, that thy days may be long upon the earth which the Lord thy God giveth thee. I've seen it not happen. Sometimes the Lord takes a good kid who's doing right, but there's a lot better possibility your days are going to be longer if you live right. But this isn't a may, this is a shall. Look in 1 Corinthians 4:5. Therefore judge nothing before the time, until the Lord come, who both will bring to light the hidden things of darkness, and will make manifest the counsels of the hearts, and then shall every man have praise of God. You know what goes on inside your heart? That filthy, deceitful, desperately wicked thing that we've been talking about. What goes on in there is one day going to come out. And the counsels, the things you've debated about back and forth and thought about in there, and the things that you won't let God take care of in there, all those things are going to come out one day at the judgment. And he says, and then shall every man have praise of God. One day it's going to come out. In that day when God shall judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ. Are you prepared for your secrets to be judged? Say, well, no, I don't want them judged. Stop sowing. Right? You know there's a way to get a crop failure? There's a biblical way where you can see precedents where people did wrong wickedly and they didn't get what was coming to them. Each one of you, if you're saved, is an example of that, right? Because you escaped hell, which was rightfully coming to us, which we sowed, and we're not going to reap. There's two kings in your Bible that you should pay attention to. One is a guy named Ahab, who was the worst king that Judah ever had. And one is a guy named Manasseh, who was the worst king that Israel ever had. No, switch that. But they were bad kings. Manasseh lived for 55 years. He reigned for 55 years. And he killed people. The Bible says he shed innocent blood in Jerusalem till it was flowing in the streets. And he got witchcraft in there and idols, and he just messed up the whole nation. You know what happened to him? God put him in prison. And then he started praying. He said, God, get me out of here. God got him out of there. And when he saw that God was real, he humbled himself. And when he humbled himself, God says, hey, I still have to judge the nation. But I tell you what, I'm not going to judge you right now. I'm going to let it pass. Did the same thing with Ahab. Let me show you that. I think it's from 1 Kings. No, 2 Kings. Go to 1 Kings 21. Sorry. 1 Kings 21. No, it's late. We'll finish up here in just a minute. He says in 1 Kings 21, look at verse 21. Behold, I will bring evil upon thee. This is God talking to Ahab through Elijah. And will take away thy posterity, and will cut off from Ahab him that pisseth against the wall, and him that is shut up and left in Israel. And I make thine house like the house of Jeroboam the son of Nebat, and like the house of Baasha the son of Ahijah, for the provocation wherewith thou hast provoked me to anger, and made Israel to sin. Look at verse 24. Him that dieth of Ahab in the city the dogs shall eat, and him that dieth in the field shall the fowls of the air eat. Verse 25. But there was none like unto Ahab, which did sell himself to work wickedness in the sight of the Lord, whom Jezebel his wife stirred up. And he did very abominably in following idols, according to all things as did the Amorites, whom the Lord cast out before the children of Israel. And it came to pass, when Ahab heard those words, that he rent his clothes, and put sackcloth upon his flesh, and fasted, and lay in sackcloth, look at that, and went softly. And the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite, saying, Seest thou how Ahab humbleth himself before me? Because he humbleth himself before me, I will not bring the evil in his days. But in his son's days will I bring the evil upon his house. Humble yourself. Humble yourself. God says, hey, you need to get this right. You need to fix this. You need to stop this. And you say, God, I'm sorry, you're right. I've sinned against the Lord. And you humble yourself. Whatever you lay on me, I'll take. And I'll take it without complaining about it to everybody else that I'm reaping what I sowed. But I'll just take it because it's my sowing, it's my reaping. It's rightfully mine. I'll just take it and I'll be quiet. And God, humility happened with the two worst kings in your entire Bible. And judgment passed over them because of humility. But when you harden yourself and you say, I ain't doing it. And you resist God and you say, lay off me. There's time enough for that. Judgment comes. Napoleon said, in every battle, there are 10 minutes on which hangs the fate of nations. And maybe the next 10 minutes will decide how much reaping, how much sowing is left. This is the time of decision. Ahab humbled himself, and God says, okay, I'll give you mercy. And I hope you do that tonight. Say, I want the mercy of God. The Bible says, sow in righteousness, reap in mercy. Humble yourself. Let's pray.